both of you guys entered the Alice Cooper world in opposite ways, I would say. Like, you join live, and then you find a way in the studio at some point, you know? And I think it's the other way around for you when you were on board in studio, and then we are asked to go live. So can you go back to... I mean, you might be the longest...
I never thought about it that way. But the best story of all time, I think, though, is that Tommy didn't he had a history with Alice Cooper before he was even in the band.
I was a runner.
Yeah, he had a job in the 1990s, I think, where he drove our van for a very short time. And then, you know...
When you were in the band, like...
When I was in the band.
During 96, you were right.
So he went... He had a best. He went from driver right into the studio with Alice Cooper, then into the live band. And
I don't know if that's ever been mentioned in an interview once.
No. But here's the thing. We've
exposed him.
Yeah. That's cool.
It's a big story of success. I mean, it's a fairy tale, right? It's rock and roll fairy tales. But I guess I did it more of the old-fashioned way, and I tried out with a bunch of other shredder guitar players in 1996. It was only going to be a one-year tour, and there was a bunch of guys like, I think the guitar player in Dream Theater, Warren DeMartini was at the auditions as well, and Red Beach, who ended up becoming the guitar player. So I knew that Alice had his shredder guitar player already, so... At that audition, I said, maybe he needs a rock and roll guitarist, too. And luckily, I played a little bit more rock and roll than anybody else that day, and I got the gig.
Yeah, it's cool. And it was transitioning to going back to the classic. I mean, the first record you did was like a metal one, Blue Planet.
The very first record I did, that was the first time I ever stepped on stage with Alice Cooper. The first time I ever played on stage with Alice Cooper was a live recording.
Fistful of Alice. My first Alice Cooper I bought when I was 15. It's the first I bought. Yeah.
Well, there you go.
I was 15
so I'm your original guitar player.
Yeah, you're definitely the longest one, anyway.
Yeah, as far as whether I've been touring and not touring this year or that year, I've definitely been in the camp for a long time.
Yeah. I think so. Yeah, I think so.
Have you been longer than Chuck?
In the camp.
Yeah, total. Yeah.
In the camp. Yeah. Like, there's been, obviously, Chuck has toured the most consecutive years in a row, but I've been hanging around.
Yeah.
For a long time.
I've been a piece of mold.
It's all for you, Tommy, like, to... Before, like, besides being the runner, driver and stuff like that. How did you, like, connect with Alice, like, some years after that to...
Yeah, well, it's a funny story, because Alice came to my house when I was producing this band called Still Standing, that Calico was going out with the guitar player, was a boyfriend, and they were like, Alice Cooper wants to come by the house and listen to what we're doing. And then Alice came by again, and he's like, I remember you, blah, blah, blah. And then never saw him again until I moved to Nashville. I was working in Nashville, and I was doing like all these records and stuff, and Bob Ezrin wanted to sign some band I was working with. And he contacted me, and then the first gig I did was Lou Reed with him. And then he wanted to do a bunch of Alice stuff, and that's how it happened.
Okay. And since then you stuck like in the studio environment?
I was working in the studio. Alice came in and he asked Bob who played this and who did that. And Bob said Tommy did it. And then Alice looked at Steve Hunter, because we were working with Steve at the time too. And he's like, you want to be in the band? And I was like...
Why not?
I said, I can't give you... Because I was like working in the studio. I wasn't doing the live thing, you know what I mean? So I said, I need a little time to think about it, you know?
Yeah.
And then I got back to him, I think it was like a couple, maybe, I don't know, like a month or two later. And then I was like, yeah, fuck it, we'll try it. See how it goes. And I even said the same thing, I'll try it for a year. If I don't like it, it'll be cool. And he's like,
and then it's like a commitment to her, because Alice, although he didn't tell his 70s, is pretty active for a rock star in his 70s, you know what I mean?
He's like, more active than any rock star in their 40s.
Exactly.
You know, let's be honest.
He tours
more than any of the bands that are out there on big tours he's today because he just keeps working. And I have to understand, I joined the band in 1996, and although I've played, you know, done my solo stuff, and I've done the records with Slash and Tal Bachman and, you know, Casablanca, you know, he's never taken a year off.
Yeah.
He's consistently toured since 1996, and I'd be pressed to find any other rock and roll artist that's done the same.
Yeah, yeah.
And he works long too. Nice. He's not working like a couple weeks. He's working like 7-8 months out of the
real
year.
Real tour? Yeah. Real tours. Yeah, real tour. Yeah,
guy's an animal.
So there's no sign of retirement.
Him? No, I don't think so.
Keep on going.
Yeah. He ain't going anywhere.
And so obviously like Nida comes more from like a shred era and metal stuff and stuff. And you guys seems to be like from the same school in a way, like more from the classic rock school, or maybe it's just my perception. I see you maybe being more in the classic rock side of things. Maybe you more on the a little bit punk rock edge, maybe.
But it's just maybe he's more of a rock and roll, way better guitar player than I could ever be. Yeah, I'm actually, you know, so I like, the punk thing, but the rock thing too. You know what I mean? We all grew up on the same stuff.
We grew up on. Yeah. To me, it is rock and roll, and rock and roll encompasses metal. It does encompass punk rock. Yep. It doesn't, you know, blues rock.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, the way that we sort of our roles in the band. I think we do a pretty good job of playing the songs in the spirit of which they were recorded. And the biggest challenge for us is that we have so many great bands to replicate. We have so many great lineups that Alice has had over the years of these classic bands, whether it's the original Michael Bruce and Glenn Buxton guitar duo, or if it's Steve Hunter and Dick Wagner combination. We have to sort of live up to that standard, and I think Tommy and I do a good job of really studying the songs and playing them in that spirit.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's what I just told Nila. Yeah. Like, to me, like this lineup, I'm involved since 20 years, like of Alice Cooper. Yeah, I saw Alice live since 20 years. The first time was so. To me, this lineup actually, like since 5 years, might be the most solid one I saw.
Yeah.
I might be wrong, but this is the most consistent lineup since the original lineup.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been the longest standing lineup since the original lineup, which is something proud of, because, I mean, not very many bands, he's had so many really good lineups, like I said, over the years, but this is the one that's lasted just almost as long as the original now.
So you're a free guitar band, and so sometimes I know, like, being in a band with two guitar players can be sometimes a pain in the ass. So with three guitar players, how do you do, like, who plays what and stuff like that, you know? Like, how do you rehearse, basically? Because you guys all are spread out around the globe, right?
Yeah.
So you live, like, not nearby at all.
Well,
so
me and Ryan are on the same time grid, time zone. Yeah. So
with the internet, we kind of we do actually film our guitar parts on our iPhones, send them over, and then, you know, the other, you know, whoever gets that video of us playing our guitar parts can go, okay, well, I know he's gonna play that.
Yep.
Maybe she can play this, and or, you know, or maybe Nita goes, okay, I'm playing this, and then I can play what she's not playing. And I think the way that we balance out the guitar solos and the parts is really dictated on what type of song it is. And that's pretty obvious, you know, when you take a look at the set list.
Because you got more songs from the 80s as well. So
I guess we never go, well, I'm playing this solo.
It's just natural.
Organically, it just goes, this sounds like Roxie would play this. Oh, this sounds like I can play this. It's totally needed doing that.
Yeah.
So it happens that way. It's pretty funny. And then when we're in the studio, when we're rehearsing, it would be like, all right, you know what, you just keep on playing that part, I'll just play this part. It's never any arguments, ever.
Yeah.
No, there's no ego between any of us when it comes to that stuff.
And there's no, like, really, like, so for, I said, like, the this tour, like, is, the set list is quite different from the last one from 2 years ago, so.
Yeah.
But so for rehearse, you don't really rehearse, like, I mean, before tour, or do you maybe?
Well, I think we put a lot of pre-production on our own.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess a blessing and a curse of this lineup is that we do play so well together. We don't always have enough time before the tour because, you know, to be honest with you, people assume that we're just going to get it together.
And
we do, but it's always nice to have a little extra time. You always want more time, but then again, I think we do a pretty good job of throw and go. They call that kind of stuff throw and go. And the reason why this set list is so different is not just because Alice wanted a new show, but I think the fans wanted to hear a lot of these songs that we're playing. And so Alice listens to his fans, and some of those choices that are new are
The throwback to the 80s, like, is quite surprising because it's been a long time those songs have been, like, on the show.
Bed of Nails has not been in the set ever since I was in the set. We played it once in Greece in 2004. Wow. But that the reaction of that song, you'd be amazed. Well, you'll see it tonight,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That's going really well, that song.
And, it's usually Halley's, like, who shows for, we're going to play this, and so learn those songs.
Yeah, exactly. We got an email with about,
but it sounded to me like it was for to please Nina as well, because I know she's a fan of Kane Roberts, stuff like that, you know? So, but, okay. It's
we all campaign for the songs that we kind of are fans of as well. And, I do like those classic rock. And luckily, the big guitar riffs are included in the set. You know, like, to be able to play that opening riff to "School's Out" every night is such an it's a cool feeling
too. Yeah,
because you know, just the power of playing that riff can incite a lot of emotion in a fan.
And memories too.
Memories.
Also, I remember.
And so you went back to the 80s on this tour. Like, next time you should go back to the funkier era, like "Go to Hell" or "It's Hot Tonight," stuff like that. That would be great. Like,
I mean, that's a great era that I like. But I mean, there is some 80s songs, but if you think about it, Dead Babies.
Oh, yeah,
Dead Babies
back.
Is
My Stars. Back
My Stars. Those are
Muscle
deep
Love.
70s.
Muscle of Love is kind of funky.
Yeah. Those are all mid 70s classics that are maybe not classics, they're kind of underground.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, when you hear them live, cuts. I think you really appreciate them being musical.
Yeah. Okay. And so, let's talk about so the new hippie. I don't really know who plays on it because I didn't have much info on the hippie. So is it only like Detroit guy? Or?
It's all Detroit guys.
It's Detroit guys, yeah.
Okay.
Tommy's got some writing on the album. With
there's
with
the song you wrote on
then,
the
then
Eyes
then
of Alice
song,
Cooper.
Yeah. There's
like
a song, Detroit,
Detroit City, which changed. The chorus changed. And, I saw you get some. You changed the chorus.
A song
maybe?
Called Go Man Go. We did this song.
Yeah, Go Man Go. That one's great.
We did with Wayne Kramer. And that's new on the record. But none of us were there. I mean, they went to Detroit and they did it all in Detroit. With all these old Detroit cats and stuff like that, with Wayne and stuff like that.
So it's really like Wayne Kramer and Mark Farner play all the guitars and stuff. Or maybe we're just doing leads and there's
a
guy who's doing the
backing
tracks.
But it is all like guys that played with Alice Cooper back in the 70s too, like the drummer and stuff like that. I don't know these guys' names, but they're all Detroit guys.
Okay.
Yeah. And even there's one song on the album that I was able to participate because it's Detroit 2020.
Yeah,
I like the performance of the song, the overall. I like the take that he did on it, and I think it elevated the song. And maybe something will happen with it. Hey.
Yeah, you will try to play some live.
To me, it's a perfect postcard for Detroit. If you're a sports team or you're you're on the tourist board, you want to draw people in excitement and interest in Detroit. That song definitely does it.
Yeah,
it makes
you
interested in Detroit.
What's the thing with the number 77?
The number 77.
Because you're really associated with.
I've been asked that question before. People call me 77. To be honest with you, it started out as more of a joke because I wanted to have a memorable signature. And I used to sign my name Ryan Roxie 77 because I wanted people to think they got a classic signature. Because at the time I was playing with a guy named Gilby Clark, who was in Guns N' Roses in 1993. So he was signing his autograph, Gilby Clark, GNR 93. At that time, there was no rock and roll band that could even touch that. So I said, I'll just sign mine 77, so it's a little bit more classic. And then I started thinking and realizing that most of my favorite artists and some of my favorite albums all came out in that year. So if you go and do a little Google search of 1977, you'll find out that was a very, really important year for music. So check it out.
Okay. And so, can you tell me about, like, your plan with, like, you got some at least two other bands, like Roxie 77 and
Well, Roxie 77 eventually was under my sort of solo project world, right? Whether it's Dad's Porno World Mag or Roxie 77. But last year I put out an album called, and it's still
Which
getting
is solo,
released,
yeah.
A solo album called Ryan Roxie Imagine Your Reality. And what I've been doing is just putting out singles every few months to promote it until the album has some sort of longevity. And then on the down times of when Alice Cooper isn't touring, I try to do as much touring on it on my own and promote it as much as I can. And that's a pure rock and roll album. And look at this.
Yeah.
This is awesome. We now have Shade.
Yeah. It's probably on time.
So I basically made a guitar-driven album because the producers said, you know, Tommy was one of the producers on the album. Yeah, he said, look, let's make an album where it features some guitars on it, man. People know you from Alice Cooper as a guitar player, so why don't you just do that? And that's, I think, basically what we did.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And I've heard on the internet, like you work with people like Lady Gaga, stuff like that and stuff, but I never, like, found any trace of it and stuff.
Yeah,
so,
on her first record, I was working with her on that, but it didn't work out that way, because I wasn't politically correct enough.
Oh, yeah.
Tommy doesn't play the game, which is credit to him.
He does. I could have.
No, but he does his thing, and he does it the way he wants to, and that's why, you know, you can hear it. Obviously, you can hear it. There's a lot of Tommy's influence in the newest Hollywood Vampires record.
Hey.
You know? Yeah, there it is.
It's a good record. It was fun, you know. It was easy. It was like working with Johnny's just very easy.
Yeah, because you're the main writer. You and Johnny, I guess.
All his lyrics. You know what I mean? Alistair wrote some lyrics, but they're definitely like mostly Johnny's.
Yeah. I guess Joey's busy with Aerosmith.
But he wrote too. Yeah, everyone contributed. You know what I mean? But me and Johnny did like the bulk, the heavy lifting and stuff like that. Glenn played on it. He did all the drums. And it was like one of those things where we did the whole record in 41 days, wrote it, everything.
It was in Johnny's studio, right?
Yeah, he has a studio where he lives. He has multiple houses where he lives, and in one house is a studio downstairs. In the basement is like a tracking room, rehearsal room. Then is his studio, and then upstairs is my studio. So we'd be going back and forth all the time. So we were able to get a lot of stuff done in a short amount of time.
Okay, so we got a good partnership. I mean, I know he was a guitar player before being an actor, but for most people, obviously, he's an actor.
Yeah.
First and foremost, you know. So, yeah.
He can play anything you put in his hands, he can play it.
Mm. A lot of people don't know that I was an actor before I was a guitar player. I did a school play.
A lot of people don't realize that, you know what I mean? That he really loves music and that's his passion. You know what I mean? He just lucked out with the movie thing, you know, because he needed money and get a job. Nicolas Cage told him to go on an audition and the rest is history.
Yeah.
But you know what? I mean, I don't know how much you chime in about how you're going to break up the interviews and stuff like that, but I will say, if someone's asked me, like, who was, of all the people that come up and guest with Alice Cooper, because we do get a lot of great guitar players that come up and guest, they go, of all the guitar players, you know, what can you say about Johnny Depp? And I said, well, he was definitely the most prepared. Everyone. He put his, like, I guess the way he would prepare for a movie role, he prepared the music and he knew all the tunes and he played a lot of them with us when he came up and jammed in the Alice Cooper band. You know, he knew seven songs, eight songs, all the parts down. And usually that's not the case with guys that come up and jam with us. They kind of go, I know
comes
that.
Out at the end.
Oh, I know that. And then you know, because Alice Cooper music is more complicated than you think.
This layer and stuff, like the mini guitar and stuff like that.
It really it is.
It's more musical than you think. When you break down those albums, there's a lot of
what's going on? Because stuff got horns and stuff like that as well. Keyboard parts sometimes and stuff like. And imagine the Hollywood Vampire thing, like. It shows also, like, Alice is really busy because he's not only busy with his own thing.
Yeah.
He, like, added, like, another thing. So.
Exactly. I mean, we did vocals on
it's
the
crazy,
road.
It's crazy.
In the dressing room. That we did most of his vocals on the road in the dressing room. Right. Or in a hotel room. You know, I just set up the laptop and we just do it right there.
On my solo album, Tommy recorded a lot of we recorded a lot of the guitars and vocals
in, hotel
rooms on days off, and we kept a, kept most of the stuff.
Yeah,
kept all of it. You know, we put real drums on it.
Technology is great too.
Yeah.
The only thing we can't fit in hotel rooms is Glenn's drums.
Yeah.
But even though he plays his drums all day long in his hotel room.